and welcome to another edition of Our Faith, Our Diocese. I'm Dan Gallagher. We come to you now from St. Faustina's Parish in Nanticoke, where members of this parish community came out in force to witness a cherished Advent tradition, the Miracle of Bethlehem. Last year, they had to cancel the play due to the pandemic, but fortunately, they were able to open their doors to the public this year and welcome people back for the 10th edition of this play. As you're about to see, the Miracle of Bethlehem is a vivid reminder to this faith community of what Advent and Christmas are truly all about.
Because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit.
I think it starts with the first word, miracle. You know, the idea that a miracle is a gift of God that is unexpected. And when you think about the ability to come together in unexpected ways, to see people that you may not have seen before or that you haven't seen in a while because of the pandemic that we've been going through over the past 2 years, to gather together again as a family of faith, a family of the people in the greater Nanticoke area and the surrounding areas, just coming together and sharing the miraculous gift of God's love that's given to us in Christ is a great grace. And I think that's what inspires so many people to come to the Miracle of Bethlehem here at St. Faustina's Cultural Center, but also to take that miracle with them to their families and then come back again after the Advent season to the Christmas season, which is what we're all looking forward to.
Early in the year, I ran across people in the community and our parishioners who told me that they missed the play. And their first question was, are we doing it this year? So it was that they missed it very much, but they did also intimate that it was the start of the Christmas holiday for them. They felt that so comfortable with it. It was the start of their joyous season. And so that was what they missed, and they wanted to get back to it as soon as we could do it.
Don't be afraid.
I really do feel that's what the Miracle of Bethlehem is really all about. It's getting the people back into going to church, celebrating the Christmas holiday, as well as telling the story and the true meaning of Christmas.
It's an absolute one of the best ways to prepare because, again, it really talks about the real meaning of Christmas, the birth of Christ and things like that, that people sometimes let it slip from their memory because they're more worried about decorating this or doing that. But when they come and see the miracle, then I think it prepares them a little bit more. It gives them a little bit more knowledge of really what the season is all about. That it's not about the toys under the tree and things like that. It's about what happened so many years ago.
It just brings Christmas into your lives. It really does. I mean, the activity, the ending is breathtaking. It's really, really wonderful.
You know, there's been so much commercialism in the holiday that we forget the true meaning of it. And the true meaning of it is we're celebrating a birthday. And it's one of the most miraculous birthdays that ever occurred. I feel sorry for the people who didn't attend because they don't know the treasure that they're missing.
It puts me in with the season of Advent and into the season of Christmas, and it helps me to think about what is going on up there on the stage about Jesus's life. Seeing the kids' faces when Jesus rose from the dead, they just couldn't wait to come and see him, like doing that. That was like the best for me, is to see the kids' faces.
You know, it's one thing to talk about the Christmas story, and it's one thing to see it on TV, but to be in person, sit here in person and see the actors, to see all that's going around, see the animals, and to have that picture. Now you're using all your senses for faith. Not only you're hearing it, and you're hearing the beautiful music, but now you're seeing it portrayed. And when I looked out, I saw the scene with Jesus and Mary and Joseph. the nativity scene. So I think the fact that you're able to see something with your eyes, it registers and it touches your heart. And I believe the children probably love it. Well, adults will love it too. And I think the adults are surprised how much they enjoy watching the play take place. And that's another reason this play is beautiful. It's when families come together, they experience it together. And so this family time, I think the Lord works through the family.
Like so many other parishes across the diocese, St. John the Baptist here in Larksville has had to face its share of challenges over the past year and a half as a result of the pandemic, including the cancellation of its annual Advent pierogi sale. Today, however, the operation is back in force, making pierogies and building community.
Pierogies are kind of synonymous with Christmas, just like the Christmas tree in the manger. And of course, I think that the dough, the wheat, is very, from what I know of food-wise, it's symbolic of the Eucharist. And so you have the dough and the wheat, and it's an honoring of our Lord Jesus. And so that's taking the table at church and extending it to the table at home. And I think that that is part of the major popular reason. I think too, I know on a personal note, my mother would always make pierogies on the Sunday before Christmas. And so you know, have those wonderful memories, and I think pierogies bring back those wonderful memories to people with their loved ones that are no longer here too. So it's like uniting past and present, and what they do here at church, it's uniting what we do at Mass with their tables at home. I'm just amazed and grateful. I mean, to get this number of people anytime, and with the pandemic, of course, and they're all double vaccinated, you know, that was a requirement to make this. So what happens is the fact that it's that sacrifice of that time. It's just a lot of hard work. And some of them come here at 3 in the morning to begin the stoves, the boiling the guys do, 3:30, you know, some of the prep. So, I mean, that's a lot of sacrifice and a lot of love for their parish. And I think they extend that love to the tables of the people when they take them home with them. And I think it's banding together that for some, this is a social thing once a week that some of them don't have the rest of the week. So you have all these dynamics coming together.
So I'm one of the dessert people.
I love it because we all get together and everybody loves to be together, and it really is a mission of love. We get to share our good pierogies with all the people all around the valley. And the people that are here are older and they're more experienced, and they come because they love to do it. I think it's passed on from generations that their grandparents, their great-grandparents, they all made the pierogies when there was lots of churches and everybody volunteered, and it's getting smaller now, so we're doing our part to spread the tradition. I ask one person if they want to come, and they'll bring a friend. But most of the people here, I've been here, they're long-term. They've been doing it for like 30, 40 years. So I'm like one of the newer comers, but people just want to come, they enjoy a nice lunch with us, and it's just good friendship.
We all have a specialty here, and everybody knows their job, and it just goes really smooth.
And why does this community look forward to these pierogies? Why are they such a hit here?
It's an old tradition, and at the holidays, it's a great thing to have at your table. Well, we'll talk about it a couple days before and call each other sometimes, and we just look forward to it. It's you know, good to be with these people.
Well, my grandparents are here, and it's just like fun, I guess. It's not like work, like doing chores or anything. It's like being with friends that of my grandparents, and I've gotten to know them a little bit better, so I like that.
And what is your responsibility here?
Well, we pass out the discs that make, like, the dough that makes the pierogies that covers up the, I guess, the potato batter. And sometimes we take the done pierogies over so they could get cooked.
It makes me spend time with friends and family and helping people.
And what do you think of the new friends you've met through this whole project?
Pretty good.
Really?
Yeah.
And what is your job here today?
Passing out discs and putting the pierogies over there and thing to get cooked.
So even though you're working quite a bit, do you think you're really having a good time and enjoying this?
Yes.
Why?
I don't know why. it's just fun. It's not like doing chores.
And does it make your Christmas season a little bit happier doing this?
Yes.
We're bringing back, little by little, what we're able to, the beauty of the past, altered with guidelines to the present, and I think it lends a sense of normalcy, and as we always say, a new normalcy, and I think that's why people are thrilled to be back, and they feel that this Advent and Christmas is a far better already experience to be as it approaches.
We come to you now from Holy Family Parish in Luzerne, one of three parishes in our diocese that are carrying on a very special Advent tradition dating back to 2009. Each year, choir members from Holy Family join forces with the choirs from Our Lady of Mount Carmel and Saints Anthony and Rocco parishes in Dunmore to present this program as their special gift to the community. As we're about to see, this service affords those in attendance an opportunity to embrace the season of Advent and its spirit of preparation through both song and word.
Have you seen the newborn King? Born in a manger. Have you seen the newborn King? Born today in Bethlehem.
The diocese has put a big emphasis on trying to collaborate among parishes. So we took it a little bit farther. We just didn't look at our close neighbors. We decided to do something that crossed counties. And we do the same service in both places. We do the service here in Luzerne, and then we do it again in Dunmore. It'll be done in Dunmore in 3 days. But it's the exact same service, so people have two opportunities. And there are some people who will not be able to come to one of them who will say, well, I'm going to go to the other one because they want to be part of it, even though it's not their parish. And I think it reaches a tremendous number of people, and it brings the gospel message and that Advent message of hope to so many more people than we could reach independently. I think, you know, it's a unique and new tradition that they've all welcomed because it really does help them to prepare for Christmas in a very special way. There's so much that you do, and you hear Christmas carols, and you know, people are rushing around to get ready for Christmas. But this is a really unique opportunity to spiritually prepare. Alone, separately, we're all pretty good, but together we're really great. And most years we have a choir of between 50 and 60 voices. Now this year we still have some people who are a little reticent about coming back to sing. So we have a choir of about half that size, but I always say it's not quantity, it's quality.
Year after year, it came together rather smoothly after the first couple of years. There was a couple of hiccups, but every year it seemed to get better and people were more excited to do it. And we usually have a choir of about 60 people that sing, and there's maybe 12 instrumentalists. And it's really a great sound. And you know, there's not many places that could produce that kind of sound with that number of people. And so people are excited to be a part of it. And it does remind us of what we can do when we come together to make a joyful noise for God, if you will, because really that's what it's about, being a part of a joy-filled celebration in the season of joyful expectation called Advent. So- We create a theme every year, and what it tries to do is to have the readings have us reflect upon the theme. So themes of Advent are waiting, joyfully expecting the coming of the Lord is with us. Whatever the theme is that we settle on, then we seek to find music that fits that theme, as well as readings from Old Testament right through the New Testament, with the birth of Christ being the culmination of the scripture readings, because it's all about our journey, really, from darkness to light, from being a person in sin to a person who's received God's salvation. And so the music tries to uplift us and to remind us what the purpose of the scripture is. The scripture tries to remind us that God has loved us and God has been working for our salvation from the very beginning of time. So we want people to be excited about that. And then the music tries to reinforce that. So they play against each other, and they're really important to have both.
many years that we've been doing it. We have both our small community choirs, and then we have this choir, which brings everybody together. And it's just the friendships that you grow and the support that you get from each other. It's just amazing. Just being able to sing for him. We all sing together, and that's for him. And hopefully it gets out there.
What the concert and the program and the readings try to do tonight is to remind people that we're called to gather together as a church and to be filled with a sense of hope, even when the world looks kind of bleak, which it's been doing for the last year and a half. So as we come out of it and we celebrate Christmas and we celebrate the holidays, we have to remember that God is still present in our life and still loves us. And hopefully tonight and Sunday night when we have this concert again, it'll be an experience of God's love and joy for them.
Jordan Glover, a senior at Holy Cross High School in Dunmore, recently designed a billboard for Mary, Mother of God Parish in North Scranton to welcome people home this Advent season. With the theme, Families Need a Stable Background, the billboard will hopefully encourage faithful to come home this Christmas and celebrate Eucharist with the rest of their parish family.
Thousands of drivers use North Main Avenue in Scranton every day. This December, Mary Mother of God Parish is hoping this new billboard, located at the intersection of Providence Road, will catch their eye and, more importantly, encourage them to come to church this Christmas.
We have to work very hard to come up with new and creative ways to get the message out, to get the invitation public. We put the little campaign-style signs all over North Scranton in visible places, shopping for a church this Christmas with our very recognizable, massive church that most people recognize if they live in the city of Scranton, at least. And the billboard was the next step up.
The billboard features the words, Families Need a Stable Background. It features a drawing of the parish along with the manger scene in front. Father Cyril Edwards asked advanced placement art students at Holy Cross High School in Dunmore for help in designing the billboard. Senior Jordan Glover responded.
I just always loved to draw and everything, even with chalk, simply on a sidewalk, even with a rock.
Now that the billboard is in place, the church is hoping people respond.
If it just catches a few eyes, you know, oh yeah, I need to get going back to church. Maybe haven't been going because of the COVID, whatever. Wherever people are, we have to try new things. The old is not good enough anymore.
It was really amazing. My mom and I went to look for it. Father Ed was saying bull's head, and I'm not from down here, so I'm like, what is a bull's head? So I'm like, Mom, let's go to Dunkin' Donuts. And we're in the parking lot. I'm like, oh my gosh, there's the billboard. So I just like driving by it now. It's really amazing that something I did is out there.
The church exists to evangelize. And Father Edwards says if this billboard can help bring one person back to church or make Jesus present to the people, the effort will have all been worth it.
In a day where the Advent season is lost through secular shopping, we have to get, if we're not reaching the family, we're wasting our time. And if it's not about the stable, then we're just shopping for presents. It has to be celebrating the birth of Jesus Christ. Is there room in my heart?
We come to you now from St. Faustina's Parish here in Nanticoke, one of many parishes across the diocese that are busy preparing for the upcoming celebration of Christmas. As he reflects on the journey of the Holy Family to Bethlehem, the pastor here, Father Brian Van Fossen, looks back on the many challenges we have faced over the past couple of years and reminds us of the great opportunity that Christmas affords us to experience God's great love.
As we come to this Advent season, we so often forget about the journey of the Holy Family as they were making their way to Bethlehem. Many times when we think about that time, we think of it maybe perfectly, but in reality, that time was rather imperfect. Mary and Joseph not knowing where to stay. There was no way of calling ahead. There was no type of going on internet at that time in order to find a hotel. And then as they were making that journey forward, they were also passing by travelers, as those travelers were speeding by them. And they, because of Mary's pregnancy, needed to take their time. And as they were taking their time along this journey, Mary's immediacy started to grow, and Joseph's concern and franticness started to grow. And then all of a sudden they reached the small town of Bethlehem. And as they entered Bethlehem, they were pounding on doors of families, pounding on the doors of the inns, trying to find a place to stay. And instead they found a small manger, imperfect as it was, but yet it was perfect for that time. Because when they entered into that manger, when they entered into that stable, the bread of life was born. And in that bread of life, Jesus, Mary, and Joseph formed a family. Present to them was Jesus, the Son of God. And in powerful ways, they were able to understand what it meant to be family, what it meant to have a place of home, even in an imperfect world and in imperfect circumstances. Over these past 2 years, we've experienced that broken world. We've experienced a concern of last year, whether or not we would be able to celebrate Christmas. And this year, as numbers continue to hold steady or even rise, the concern of whether this Christmas will be in jeopardy. And yet here we are in an imperfect world with a perfect love of God. Jesus, who comes to us in the most blessed sacrament, who we receive in the most holy Eucharist, in order for us to be bread for others, in order for us to be family with each other, and to share that meal together. And in so many ways, and in beautiful ways, Jesus comes to us in that perfect love. St. Paul reminds us in his letter to the Romans, neither height nor depth, principality or power, angel, archangel, nothing will separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. That God is love, and all who live in love live in God, and God in them. And that love of God, which permeates our broken world, which permeates our broken hearts, which permeates our broken families, doesn't call us to be perfect, but rather calls us into love, to forgiveness and mercy. And it is that love and forgiveness and mercy that we celebrate in Christmas. The entire season of Christmas, from the beginning of the Christmas season all the way to the baptism of the Lord, reminds us that we are called into love through Jesus. And like Mary and Joseph, we are called into a family. And so as we celebrate this Christmas season, come home. Come home to the table of the Lord. Come home to the altar of God as He pours out His love to us in the most blessed sacrament. As He shares that love in a broken world to a family that He calls together as His own, a family of faith, hope, and love. St. Paul reminds the Corinthians that out of all those three, the greatest is the love. It is that love of God that we celebrate every Christmas season. It was missing a little bit when we couldn't gather. We have to be honest about that. But now that we can, now that we are able to celebrate and sing the hymns of our love of God, we are able to worship in spirit and in truth. We are able to receive Him in the most blessed sacrament. We are able to come together as a family. It is the yearning and the loving of our hearts that bring us together. And so, my brothers and sisters, come home for Christmas. Come home to a family which gives us hope in a broken world, that through the franticness and the craziness of the journey, take time to listen to the angels singing of the glory of God, to experience a silent and a peaceful night, a holy night, to come home and to rest in the loving arms of God.
That's all the time we have for now. On behalf of the staff at Catholic Television, I'd like to thank you for joining us today and invite you to tune us in again for our next edition of Our Faith, Our Diocese. We close today's program with another selection from the Advent service at Holy Family Parish in Luzerne, Hark the Herald Angels Sing. For now, I'm Dan Gallagher wishing you and your family a very merry and blessed Christmas.